Yes. Okay, I gotcha.
All right, very fine. Good. All right.
Wow, all that's right. Clear.
Yeah. It is an improved system over the other one, I believe. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, good. So, how are you feeling?
I am fine.
Okay.
I mean, I have a lot going on, just, you know, life. I'm moving to Vermont. I'm selling my apartment in Brooklyn where my dad was. I'm just kind of crazy working. I'm doing my thing. You know, relative to my father, he was so sick. And, you know, I'm totally sad and relieved. And just starting to be able to miss him. I couldn't miss him while he was still alive, even though he was pretty gone. So, I don't really think that I'm gonna feel that much about that. I mean, obviously I do, but I'm too busy moving. Mm-hmm. So once that settles down, I'm sure there will be more there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you have the sense that you were mourning him as he progressively deteriorated from this devastating disease?
Yeah, I did. And I mean, you know, you met Michele. So she, as our care manager, was just amazingly helpful. And it kind of felt like every time there was another step down, we would say, God, I can't believe this is even worse than before.
Oh my.
Just like constantly, every time felt closer to the end, but excruciating and never ending.
Could you give me just maybe one example of how another thing happened that you didn't expect that was so devastating?
Well, I mean, probably the biggest change, you know, we moved my dad from Florida in 2012 after my mom died, and he kind of had a little bit of a resurgence in a way. He got a little better almost, and he was living not on his own, but with AIDS. But he was kind of living his life, and I mean, I was still very involved. But then he started really being just terribly paranoid, and, you know, he started complaining about how a cleaning service was coming into his house at night and moving all his papers around, and... things like that. You know, me and Michele were running a project and he wasn't aware of the details, and he just was crazy in those ways.
Oh, I see. Confused
and paranoid, and just that was really hard to deal with, yelling at us and just completely illogical and irrational.
And not like his old personality at all.
No, completely not. Completely opposite of how he was.
Sure, yeah.
That's just one example. I mean, you know, another big step was after we moved him from the brownstone to my apartment, my husband's apartment, and we moved out and lived upstairs. And a couple of months after we moved him, there was some incident, and I came down in the morning and he was like really out of it, lying on the bed, couldn't move, couldn't drink. This was about a year and a half ago, and I called Michele, we called 911 because we thought maybe he had a stroke or something. And he wasn't, you know, he wasn't as bad before that time. And he was in the hospital for about a week, and they couldn't really find anything. They basically just said his brain looks like that of a dementia. And so that was a big, and then he was left in the wheelchair without a lot of use of his hands. And, you know, he was just much less coherent.
Yeah. Okay. Wow. So how did the natural dying process go for him?
It was, it was an amazing process. I can't thank you enough. We were, you know, we had been trying to figure out what to do because he was so far gone, and everyone agreed that there's no way that he would want to live that way. And he had indicated that. And there was, we just couldn't figure out what to do that was legal. So, you know, when Michele found you, it changed everything. And, you know, at first when we got on the phone and we started going through the cards and, you know, went through the most, through those forms, I kind of thought to myself, ah, do we really have to go through all this? We know what we want to do. We know what needs to happen. But it was a helpful process. It really was a helpful process and kind of helped us get oriented towards what we were doing. And then we had aides, you know, personal aides for my dad round the clock. All that, we had had that for several years now. And we decided that because they were, they weren't nurses, and they loved my father. You know, he was, even in his demented state, he was very charming. And it would be very difficult for them not to feed him.
Yes.
Or give him water. And so we let them go, and we hired nurses.
Yes.
Which, you know, thank God my parents had saved some money, so they had the resources to do that. And the nurses were amazing and just so great. And he, you know, we also sedated him some so he wouldn't feel pain and be agitated. And it was a very, you know, for the most part, a very peaceful process.
Mm-hmm.
I guess we started on, I think it lasted a week, mm-hmm. 7 days.
Yeah.
He died on the 7th day. And it was hard at first because he was coming in and out of consciousness and sometimes a little agitated and breathing, you know, with some difficulty, making noises. And that, you know, maybe about the 4th day in, that pretty much stopped. And he was just sleeping.
Yes.
And peaceful. And he died very peacefully.
Yep.
You know, one second he was there, and the next he was not. And, you know, my sister and I were there, and we had, the nurse thought it was going to happen pretty soon, and we'd stayed by his side. And then his heart rate went up a little bit, and so we said, you know, let's order some food. And we were kind of chatting about what to order, and then the nurse said, girls, he's gone. And then he was gone, and it was like, it just really showed us the fine line between life and death. So there and not.
Yeah.
It was amazing. It was a great process. It was a great, great process for us. And, you know, partly I'm sure that's because we were so sure of that it was time. And we were all agreed that it was time. So it probably would have been more difficult if the family wasn't aligned.
Great. So, and your brother had no problem with it either?
No, he was, he came, he was there a couple of days before my dad died. He actually, he was, the night he died, he was on his way.
Mm.
He got there a couple of hours afterwards. And, you know, but that was his choice also. He chose not to be there
okay.
at that time. And but then maybe he changed his mind a little bit, but it took him too long to get there. I don't know.
Yeah. But your sister and you were right there with the nurse and just saw it happen and just at that very moment, which is not always possible and it's not always necessary. But it's something special when it does happen. And I've heard this before. In fact, when my stepfather died, I wrote these words that there's only one difference between his last breath and all those he had for the rest of his life before that. And that was, there just wasn't another one.
Yeah, so true.
It's just so simple.
Yeah, so true, so true. I've heard a lot of stories of where people, you know, family is around and everybody's kind of waiting for that last breath and it doesn't come and they either go for a walk or just move away for a couple of minutes and then there's the last breath. And that's exactly what happened. It's
yeah.
kind of interesting, that
yeah.
sense that a person has.
Right. So I'm glad to hear that the tediousness or complicatedness or comprehensiveness or whatever you want to call it of the going through the cards.
Yeah.
Gave you, I mean, you all came, we're all in agreement ahead of time and you yeah. all, but, and so that's unusual in a family. It was good. It made dealing with you very efficient and very easy. And so there were no conflicts to resolve, but even so going through all the scenarios of the My Way cards made you feel even more at peace with your decision and that it was the right decision at the right time.
Yeah, it did. It did. And it, maybe it, it concretized it in some way. It made it more real. Yeah, it just grounded it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Grounded it.
Yeah. Made it specific as well, perhaps.
Yeah.
And then with all these various things that you've been through so many, oh, yes, he did that and so forth. Yeah.
Right.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Good. 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 And then I think Michele was also nice to have someone who's a little bit detached and somewhat professional or actually professional. But she also was a friend as well. So the, in two yeah. roles. And so we don't usually do that. We usually, but she said, you know, I knew him way back when. So
yeah,
it was, I think also helped you to have yeah. Michele and have her opinion voiced in. Yeah. Right.
Yeah. Michele had, I've known Michele for many years in other contexts.
Mm-hmm.
And when my father moved to New York, I just happened to be talking to her about other things. And then all of a sudden I realized that this is actually what she does professionally. And so we hired her.
Right.
And I think for us, she's been so supportive throughout the whole process that it really, her being on the call just served as more support to us.
Right.
And she had her own view as a professional, as a health professional. And that was helpful.
Sure.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Good. And that Dr. Perlov, was it?
He, yeah.
He came through and the mosque was there. And you knew that it was, you were all relieved that it was legal. It was right. It was condoned. It was medically ethical.
Yeah.
Just everything just good. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, we were really flailing around trying to figure out what to do because
yeah.
it was so painful to continue to
see yeah.
him in the way that he was. And it makes no sense. ethically or legally or anything, you know, but I'm a lawyer and my brother was a lawyer. Now he's a business guy and, you know, nobody wants to get in trouble for doing something illegal, even though you know it's right.
Yeah.
So.
Right.
So it was really a lifesaver for us and also for my dad. I mean, he just, watching him waste away in those ways, even though he was already gone, it was really mostly physical at this point. It just makes no sense.
Yep, right. So you found the peaceful and legal way and all felt in agreement, in some real depth of agreement. Yeah. By the process.
We did. And, you know, my brother, maybe being a man, but also maybe being, he's 8 years younger than me, and he had a different relationship with my dad, and they did a lot of, you know, adventure kind of things together when my brother was growing up and my father was younger. And so my brother was really ready to say, you know, dad wouldn't want to be like this. Months before I was quite there.
Oh, he got there first, right.
And he, you know, he didn't push it. It's not, we didn't disagree, you know, on anything. We just had a different point of view. And, but by the time my father really was, by the time we met you, mm-hmm. we were in complete agreement, all of us.
Right. Took a while.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Good. So, all right. I don't know if I had the name of the process simplified by the when I met, was working with you in April. Perhaps I do. I did. At that time, I was calling it the consensus of substituted judgment.
Right.
It resonates for professionals and your lawyer. And,
right.
But now we're calling it something that's even simpler because everyone knows what advanced care planning is.
Right.
But it was too late for your father to do that, so we call it now care planning.
Okay.
Yeah. And yeah. And so it's a, yeah, we have to plan it now. We couldn't,
yeah.
We couldn't do it in advance. And and there are people who have to make the plan for your father by virtue of their knowing him really well.
Right.
And that's where consensus substituted judgment comes in. And if you agree, it's so it works.
Yeah.
Well, both terms are really descriptive, and I think, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And it always only applies when a person cannot feed themselves, correct?
Correct, unless they have planned ahead. And there are two scenarios where that may, we can push it a little bit earlier.
Yeah.
If someone is coughing, and that may be an indication that they're having a problem swallowing.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not a very pleasant way to die mm-hmm. by aspiration pneumonia compared to natural dying.
Right.
So if they leave in their living will the following instructions. If I have dementia, do not give me swallowing studies because I'm going to be so confused about what's going on that's going to feel like torture to me.
Right.
But if it's your best guess that I'm having problems with swallowing that could lead to aspiration pneumonia, then remember the first principle of medical ethics, do no harm, stop feeding me.
Mm-hmm.
So, and that's different than putting the food and fluid in front within of the patient and within the patient's reach, where
right.
you just stop, you just withhold the assistance of putting something in the mouth, because there you're on very solid legal grounds. You have the right to refuse
right.
unwanted treatment. You have the right to refuse an invasion of your bodily integrity.
Right.
Battery without right. your permission.
Right.
So, but this is, so if there's a risk, so we call this, and there is another alternative that some physicians will recommend, geriatricians, which is, they say, well, when you are at risk for aspiration pneumonia, even by drinking something, what you can do is thicken it. So we thicken food and fluid or nourishment
right.
Generally goes down the right pipe rather than the wrong pipe into the lungs.
Mm-hmm.
So one of my colleagues, Alex K. Smith, started what's called the Thick and Easy Challenge, I think he called it. And he and about 20 other physicians said, you know what we've been prescribing for all our patients? It's basically cornstarch.
Right.
And so let's try it ourselves. And if we can't keep it up for 8 hours, and that's the only thing we eat, everything we eat or drink is mixed with thick and easy. If we can't do that, then the penalty is for the cause, we'll contribute to a charity. No one can do it. And they hated it. Uh-huh. And when they drank it, they made just awful expressions, which they recorded on video.
Right.
So it was a very educational and benevolent job done. And so I, based on that experience, I now send a little white powder in the mail, labeling very carefully so it's not considered anything illegal.
Yeah, really.
This is just thick and easy cornstarch, or I tell them to go out to the grocery store and buy it.
Right.
Now you try it now. So suppose, Fran, you wanted to do your own advanced directive because you have a family history of advanced dementia, and you know how horrible it is. You try it, and you fill out this little form that I have prepared that says, under no circumstances do I want my food and my liquids to be thickened with thick and easy,
right,
even if my life depended upon it.
Right.
Do no harm. Withhold that from me. Then it becomes legal because you have the right to refuse something ahead of time.
Mm-hmm.
That would do you harm. Okay.
Gotcha.
Now, the third option. So first we have natural dying. Then we have withholding food if it's there, a risk of aspiration pneumonia. As any one of the cards by itself, if there's enough suffering, if the patient cannot feed himself,
mm-hmm,
is the signal for natural dying.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But someone may have two or more other severe symptoms of advanced dementia, but still, because it's such a variable disease,
right,
be able to stick his fingers in and put something in his mouth.
Mm-hmm.
So what we do is we say, if by the time I reach the stage of advanced dementia, if it's legal, then I want my proxy agents, surrogate decision makers, loved ones, to withhold food and fluid from me.
Mm-hmm.
And the analogy is this, that the food and fluid is just going to prolong my dying. And if my dying is prolonged, my suffering is prolonged.
Right.
And so it's really doing harm.
Right.
But it's obviously in an area that's very controversial.
Yeah.
Could be easily seen as negligent homicide.
Mm-hmm.
And so you don't want to put, when I write my living will, I don't want to put my loved ones who are caring for me,
right,
at that time into that situation. But it's a real good indication of what I want.
Yeah.
And by then it's legal. And I remember going to a bioethics convention maybe almost 10 years ago. And someone suggested that when you do make your living will, just in case you didn't get around to changing it in time, say, if in my state, by the time I reach this situation, physician-assisted dying is legal, they've changed the laws, then I want it under those circumstances.
Yep.
This is a way of pushing the envelope.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, as you're talking, I'm just thinking, you know, the other, I don't know if it's an advantage, but the other thing I had going here is that a very dear friend of mine works for hospice, for visiting nurse here in New York. There's a number of hospices, but the one that we had was visiting nurse. And she's an operations person there. And she happened to know, she knows Dr. Perloff. So when he wasn't getting back to us, I wrote to her and I said, Ann, help, you know. Mm-hmm. And she got to his assistant and then he got back to us and all that.
I also got to his assistant and who said he's a wonderful man.
Yeah.
And well,
that's what Ann said. And I said, well, he's not getting back to us.
Right. But he did right after that. So
yeah,
we were both parallel
playing. Yeah. But what I'm sitting here thinking is that is, and I wondered this at the time, why didn't the hospice nurses know and say to us, there's an option here.
Right.
He can't feed himself.
Yes. Okay. When Michele first called me, and I guess she found me and Caring Advocates on the internet.
Yeah.
And she said that you have been spoon feeding your father for 12 months.
Yes.
My first reaction was to say very bluntly and frankly, that's about 11 months too long. Yeah. And you agree with that. Yeah. And so what we need to do is we need to have an army of influential people sending out the word, out the message.
Yeah, but that's what I'm sitting here thinking about. Like, I want to speak to Anne, who runs operations at hospice and at VNS, and see if there's some way to impact on hospice so that nurses share this information with patients.
Okay, so here's one thing, and I've done this at a nursing college in New Jersey.
Yeah.
If Anne wants to get a group of people together, I can do a webinar.
Mm-hmm.
And educate him on this.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm gonna get in touch with her and see what she wants to do. Maybe you'll just set up an initial conversation and you can talk to her. She's great. You're great. I'm sure it'll work.
Fabulous.
Whatever she can do here.
And I'm also looking for clinically licensed people in every state, like Michele.
Yeah, like Michele.
Because I couldn't do what I could provide education to you.
Yeah.
Michele was there as a professional.
Yeah.
And so sometimes money's a problem. And so if you have a professional sitting in the room who's training with me and can bill because they're licensed in that state, because I'm only licensed in California, then it really works. So we have a training program that works. And that's how it's going to grow.
Yeah.
Because this is such a delicate and difficult area to kind of wrap your arms around and just get it that you really need a professional you can trust,
mm-hmm.
who understands it,
mm-hmm.
and can help you, can educate you and help you reach a decision when the timing is right for you, right?
Are you maintaining contact with Michele?
Actually, I haven't, but maybe could I send her a copy of this video?
Yeah, of course. And I'm going to see her on Monday. We're having dinner. And also, okay. I know that she cares deeply about these issues.
Right. Oh, I'd love to have her on our Caring Advocates team. Sure.
Yep. So
sure.
I'll mention it to her.
Good. Have her call me. Great.
Yeah. Wonderful. Yeah.
All right. Yeah. Well, so the hope is that we help your father and we don't prolong his misery. And we allow him to have a natural, peaceful, legal death. And it's also peaceful for all of his children. And that's goal number one.
Yep.
Goal number two is that you learn from the experience. You say, you know what? I have more options available, probably more timely implementation of what I want when I would really want it if I make my own living will.
Mm-hmm.
So I can go through the My Way cards and for myself, that, by the way, will probably take you an estimated 40, 45 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And get myself all set that way.
Mm-hmm.
Then we also add a ironclad strategy so that the benefit is that your father's experience teaches you what you need to do for you.
Yeah.
There's a timing here, you know, it's still kind of fresh with his experience and there's no rush about it. Don't let it go a few months, yes, a few years, because other things could happen. All right. And then the third thing is to spread the message because it's so important and because it's so needed and so not appreciated.
Yeah. I can't imagine that there aren't thousands more families who are struggling with this issue and don't know where to go.
Right. My estimate is starting with 5.5 million people who have dementia.
Yep.
43% of which, according to one estimate, are in the advanced stage of dementia.
So then we're talking about millions.
Obviously.
Yep.
2 million is a low estimate.
Yep, absolutely.
Right. Yeah, right. And so this is just the beginning, and you are one of the first.
Yep.
Right. So thank you.
Well, I'm a good advocate, so we'll see what, you know, we'll see what goes.
You're not only an advocate, you're a caring advocate. You really cared about your father. And it's been a pleasure throughout with you and your appreciation of the process and my effort and my humanistic goals here.
Yeah, that's what it is.
Yeah, right. Well,
this is not a death panel. This is a caring issue.
That's right. This is a panel to decrease unnecessary, unwanted, prolonged pain and suffering.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
Unnecessary, unwanted, prolonged pain and suffering. Yep.
Yep. Very good. All right.
All right.
So I have your permission to put this up on YouTube as a...
Absolutely.
Okay, thank you. That's wonderful. And I would look forward to seeing speaking to Michele and the person, Ann?
Ann Sutterby. I'll put you guys... Maybe what I'll do, I'll talk to her and make sure she wants to move forward, but I can't imagine she won't.
Right.
I'll put you in email contact, and then you guys can set up a call.
Okay. All right. Good luck with your move.
Thank you.
You call when you get settled in Vermont, and we'll try to get...
Yeah, I'm coming back to the Bronx. It's just temporary, but...
Oh, okay. Okay. All right. Well, you're a lovely person, a wonderful daughter.
Thank you.
And you have the spirit to feel it, so you can really care about those 2 million people.
I know.
Imagine how off you were when you said, I imagine there are 1,000. A thousand. 2,000. Wow. That's how big the problem is.
Yeah.
And it's got a nice name now called Now Care Planning.
Now Care Planning. All right, good.
All right.
All right, Dr. Terman, thank you so much. I really, the family and I just cannot thank you enough. And if you ever need anything from us like this, please just tell me.
All right. Thank you so very much. Yeah, you've been more than everything I could imagine and more. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
And you're a wonderful person, and thank you for your spirit.
You too. Thanks.
Bye-bye.
All right. We'll talk. End
meeting.
I don't know how.